Hello. Good. Hello. Oh, I love the response. Good evening, everyone. It's wonderful to have you all here at the Art Institute. My name is Emily Fry, and I'm the Executive Director of Interpretation. And I'm thrilled that you're joining us today to learn about Caravaggio and his circle from one of our most esteemed colleagues in the Department of Interpretation, who I'll introduce shortly. But just to give you some description about what this department does in interpretation, we are really focused on making artwork accessible to a wide range of audiences. And so all of our work, we work closely with curators to work on labels, on gallery conversations and tours. And so we're really focused on storytelling in the galleries, and we think a lot about visitors. So we're really excited that you're here. So as we begin, just a brief reminder to please silence your mobile devices. And now to move on with the introduction. It's my pleasure to introduce you to today's speaker, Marielle Epstein. Marielle is the Assistant Director of Interpretation at the Art Institute. And in this role, she develops exhibition texts, learning tools, and gallery narratives to enhance the visitor experience. Marielle believes that every artwork can be a springboard for inspiring, challenging, and dynamic conversations that create connection and change. So before joining interpretation, she held curatorial research and education positions at the Art Institute and other local and international institutions. Marielle holds an MA in the history of dress and a BA in the history of art and French studies. So thank you again for being here, and now please join me in welcoming Marielle to the stage.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for being here. Rome, on the eve of the 17th century, was characterized by immoderation, vice, crime, and chaos, or as Protestant reformer Martin Luther described, it was a city of perdition. Taverns were filled with drinkers, gamblers, and disbanded soldiers looking for work following a century of wars. Town squares were populated by religious pilgrims seeking alms and salvation. Many women, if not nuns or nobility, were sex workers whose clients spanned social strata. It was also a city filled with people facing extreme poverty, displaced by plague and conflict. In the narrow streets and underground spaces nestled between grand cathedrals and glittering palaces, violence, trickery, and revelry reigned. It was a population living in crowded conditions, trying to survive. This is the Rome Caravaggio found when he arrived in 1592. He was a young artist known equally for his extreme facility in painting still lifes and the human figure, and for his mercurial temper, ego, and his penchant for dueling and street fighting. Needless to say, he fit right in. Rome was also the capital of the Catholic world, containing within it the seat of the papacy and the resulting power structures of the newly reformed Catholic Church. The Council of Trent, some 30 years earlier, had reasserted the strictures of Catholicism, partially in response to the threat of the Protestant Reformation. By the end of the 1500s, the urban landscape of Rome had changed immensely and rapidly. The city was built upon layers of history and myth. Ancient ruins were surrounded by a warren of narrow medieval streets, and newly constructed long, radiating boulevards united the city as a modern Christian metropolis. New doctrines articulated the need for a strong visual program to underscore the church's teachings and power. Art, architecture, and urban space were a primary tool for communicating with Romans and travelers from throughout Europe. The church sought to communicate with the modern public, many of whom were illiterate. The prevailing style in Italian art, known as Mannerism, was perceived as florid and aristocratic, and church reformers advocated for the narrative-driven symbolic paintings devoid of impurity or gratuitous nudity. The new style of art supported by the Catholic Church needed to inspire deep feelings of spirituality and foster emotional connections to their doctrines. This created opportunity for artists who flocked to the city in search of work and patronage from all parts of Europe. They too frequented the taverns and participated in the underground subculture of the city. They created artist guilds, almost indistinguishable from street gangs or college fraternities, replete with alcohol-fueled initiation rituals and churlish antics in the square. These are the artists whose works decorate the magnificent churches and palaces of Rome. They were accountable to an elite class of rulers and clergy who purchased and commissioned their work, and with whom they feasted and drank, but equally surrounded themselves with the Roman popolo, the ordinary people. Caravaggio's sensibilities and success were produced by his context and training, and of course, by his extraordinary skill. He was born near Milan and arrived in Rome at the age of 21, where he stayed for 14 productive but tumultuous years, and then fled in 1606 to escape a murder charge. The young Caravaggio arrived hungry for work and to establish himself as a painter, striving to stand out among a competitive and scrappy pool of artists. The Art Institute's exhibition highlights two of his works from this period, Martha and Mary Magdalene and the Card Sharps, and contextualizes them among the work of his contemporaries. Some of these artists knew or worked with him personally, others knew his influence, some sued him for libel. It was during this formative Roman period that Caravaggio established the visual language for which he is best known. One of bright light and dark darks were flashes of illumination cut through heavy shadows. This is a language of profound emotionality, where human figures are unidealized, where the deepest expressions of feeling are laid bare. His paintings make pain, pleasure, desire, violence, and grief visible, and create an atmosphere of shared lives in close quarters, in and out of the shadows. In this painting, the crowd occupies an ambiguous, darkened realm and is primarily illuminated from the left by an unseen light source. The figure at right, this guy, holds a lantern, providing a secondary, gentler light, and peers over the scene, observing the crowd and the chaos to witness the biblical taking of Christ. It is said that Caravaggio used himself as a model for this figure. And as such, he transforms himself into the literal bringer of light, a figure known in the original Latin as Luciferus, and who was later co-opted by the Christian church as the devil figure, Lucifer. For us, then, Caravaggio may well be both. He who illuminates the dark, brings light to the underground, and a figure of moral turpitude who lived a life both sacred and profane. Caravaggio's sensibilities and artistic strengths have meandered through the labyrinth of time and find their corollary in the nightlife photography that emerged in the late 1970s. Nan Goldin and Wolfgang Tillmans are among the best-known artists of this category, and they operate as participant observers in the transgressive social spaces they navigate. They are emotionally, socially, and physically involved with their subjects. They are a part of the cultures which they capture and illuminate. The result is stripped of pretense, gritty, and intense. The flash of a camera exposes things normally relegated to the realm of the underground, and they contain a quality of truthfulness and compassion that shocked the establishment and fundamentally altered the landscape of contemporary photography. Considered together, visual similarities become apparent. Caravaggio introduced to painting what critic Jerry Saltz describes as whirling, corkscrewing space, shafts of light and shadow, theatricality, and, above all, a new, colossal, unideal naturalism of painting from life. He invented a kind of realism that, from its shallow space, creates a sense of containment and light that contours biblical and secular scenes that appear startlingly human and provoke an inescapable feeling of empathy. We'll focus primarily on Nan Goldin, a vanguard of this kind of photography. She first picked up a camera as a teenager and began taking snapshots of her friends, documenting relationships and moments in shared lives. From the 1970s onwards, Goldin found kinship with the bohemian artistic substrata of Boston, New York, Berlin, Bangkok, and Paris. Many of the people around her were queer, some were artists, drag queens, and sex workers who Goldin has photographed in bars, bathrooms, bedrooms, and nightclubs. She began showing these images as a slideshow in her Bowery loft, a project which became known as the Ballad of Sexual Dependency. It depicts love, violence, and intimacy, sex and drug use, getting ready and going out, with all the trouble of desire and conflict laid bare. For some viewers, Goldin's photography depicts outsiders at the margins of society. But for her, they are friends and lovers and family. In Goldin's words, there is a popular notion that the photographer is by nature a voyeur, the last one invited to the party. But I'm not crashing. This is my party. This is my family, my history. Goldin's use of chiaroscuro, the extreme contrast between light and dark, lends a moody, often melancholic quality to these moments of life. Her photographs do not display distance. She closes in on her subjects and inhabits a space that is personal or intimate. From up close and within, she invites a glimpse into the domain of touch and smell, of loving and of struggle. The shared power of these paintings and photographs is how bodies are brought in proximity to each other and to the viewer. They make us aware that we are doing the looking. When these artists invite us into their worlds and offer a look free of moral judgment, we're invited to examine the particularities of their cultural environments, the universality of the themes they yield and the emotions they affect, and what they might draw out of us as viewers today. We can examine what it means for each of these artists to be participant observers of their environments and their time, but also we can think of the paintings and photographs as objects. They are emotion holders that carry traces of the past into our shared present, and they can tell us just as much about ourselves today as they could about Nan Goldin in 1978 or Caravaggio in 1592. So let's look at these intimate spaces and examine what is confined, relegated, or cocooned within them, and let's do it as they would, truthfully and without judgment. This half-length portrait gives us a front row seat to the scene of a crime. The figures of three men fill the frame, caught in a moment of suspense. A wealthy young man dressed in black studies his cards, woefully unaware of the gambit underway, but we know. The figure with his back to us leans forward like a cat tensing to pounce, holding hidden cards behind his back and waiting for the signal from his shadowy counterpart. The men, center and right, in bombastic theatrical dress, are about to rip off the naive youth contemplating his hand. Most likely, the young nobleman found his way into a tavern to try his luck at Primero, the fashionable card game among gamblers of the day. The wily card sharps, for whom the painting is named, are going to cheat him out of his winnings. Behind his back, the younger rogue reveals a hidden hand. The man with his hand raised wears fingerless gloves to feel marked cards. Gambling was a common theme in European printmaking and literature during the 15th and 16th centuries. On one hand, published texts influenced by Christian doctrines warned against the immorality of gambling and card playing. On the other hand, these games were enjoyed by all classes, including the aristocracy, as shown by the young figure on the left. Gambling often took place in taverns, and so emerged the cheats who were mythologized in theater and in literature as roguish types who lurked in the shadows and would rob players of their winnings. As we can imagine, Caravaggio spent time among these people and likely knew them well, but here he does not depict them as he would have seen them. The theatrical quality of this scene is derived from just that, theater. This is a dramatized or fictionalized rendering meant to amuse someone who could afford to buy such a painting. This is what made it attractive to the first person who bought his work and would become his first major patron in Rome, the Cardinal Francesco del Monte. He was a member of the clergy with close ties to the Medici family, and he was a major patron of the visual arts, music, and theater. He purchased two works by Caravaggio at the same time. This is the other. It is another half-length portrait set in a shallow, ambiguous space. Here, a Romani woman acts as if she is reading the fortune of a young, wealthy man. As she holds his gaze, her fingers graze his palm as she discreetly slips the ring off his finger. Charming and duplicitous, she serves as a warning about the dangers of tavern culture, but also performs a trick for the audience. The fortune teller would have also been a stock character in the Commedia dell'arte, the popular form of theater at the time. It is a sense of the underworld made palatable for the ruling class who played games and patronized the arts, but had no real knowledge of Roman street life. Caravaggio represents his fortune teller and his card sharps in a moment of triumph. The tavern dwellers pull off their trick and the aristocrats lose. Yet by heightening the drama of the scenes and adopting a language closer to theater than to the real world, Caravaggio protects them. As the art historian Andrew Graham Dixon suggests, this may be an intentional device whereby representing these scenes as theater rather than a reprehensible reality, there is no suggestion of these figures' abjection or desperation. The gamblers, the Romani women, the urban poor who deceive to survive in this moment reverse the social order and win, and still amuse and delight the audience who are clued into the ruse. Like Caravaggio and against him, Nan Goldin knows that within the underworld exists a world of theater. Her subjects dress up and role play, inhabiting personas that enable them to affirm their genders and their identities and to escape them. Among all performances and presentations, there is a fluidity. Here, Goldin photographs Trixie seated atop a ladder. The setting is wood paneled and dark, and the ladder is industrial and dirty. Trixie wears a white dress with layers of tulle hiked up to reveal stockinged legs, and just her manicured hand hides her genitals. Her makeup is exaggerated and ghoulish, and she strikes a confident pose while taking a drag from a cigarette. Goldin photographs her from below, aggrandizing and elongating her. This image was created on the set of the film Liberty's Booty by filmmaker Vivian Dick, which explores prostitution from the female perspective, both in terms of agency and exploitation. It is part documentary and part performance, and remains unclear who among the women featured in the film were sex workers. In this image and in the film, Trixie performs femininity for the camera with a heightened sense of subjectivity and farce. Then, moments before or after, we see Trixie again, this time descended from her perch and seated low to the ground, cigarette in hand. She is slumped over on a cot, surrounded by detritus and disarray, and appears diminutive from the high angle of the camera. Goldin offers a glimpse behind the scenes, revealing what happens when the performance stops. It is a moment of melancholy, of darkness, when the mask comes off after the party. Many of Goldin's friends were drag performers, men who dressed as women and women who dressed as women. playing a role contingent upon a heightened sense of femininity. This photograph pulls back the curtain, asking what part of it is performance, perhaps for Vivian Dick's film, and what part of it is about engaging with the questions central to the subject's life. What is agency? What is safe? What is exploitation? What is authentic? Who does the performance serve? Art critic John Berger offers a discussion of Caravaggio and his context that also applies to Nan Goldin. He writes, "The underworld is full of theater, but one that has nothing to do with either cosmic effects or ruling class entertainment. In the daily theater of the underworld, everything is close to and emphatic. What is being played may at any moment become for real. There is no protective space, no hierarchical focus of interest. Caravaggio was continually being criticized for exactly this, the lack of discrimination in his paintings, their overall intensity, their lack of a proper distance." Caravaggio uses the same composition in this early painting of Mary Magdalene. She assumes a humble posture with eyes closed and her head bowed. A single tear falls down her cheek. This occurs during a moment of inward reflection or grief following Jesus' death, where she would have renounced hedonistic pleasures and entered a hermetic period. In this austere, shallow space, jewels are cast aside and scattered on the floor. Most depictions of Mary Magdalene at this time would have represented her nude and sexualized. Caravaggio's painting of her sorrow does neither. It humanizes the figure, representing her with truth and respect. Indeed, Caravaggio did not discriminate here, and his painting has no proper distance from the subject. The model for this work was likely Anna Bianchini, a sex worker who posed for him on several occasions and was among several others who he employed as models. This work, like many others, was received with criticism and praise. For some, it was too real, too close, too jarring. For others, this image brought a biblical figure to life. For Caravaggio, some historians suggest that there may have also been a layer of contemporary social critique. Courtesans, whose clients included the rich and the poor, were publicly abused by police, and documents from Anna Bianchini's life indicate that she may have been whipped. The unguent jar next to her at the bottom left may serve two functions. One as a convention long associated with the Magdalene figure, and another as a salve for her injuries. These artists and their subjects walk the line of performance and reality, alternating between the masked, confident character and pulling back the curtain to glimpse the person underneath. Performance engenders the creation of a self-image or allows the artist and subject to tell their own version of the story of their friends and their community. Sometimes it's Anna Bianchini who assumes the role of Mary Magdalene, but only barely. Or it's Trixie, still dollified. To viewers, these images read like cinema, and we are convinced by the characters, but to the subjects, they are themselves. Goldin has described her peers as people who were running away from America, and they found each other. They didn't think they were pioneers or rebels, they just were. It was about living out what they needed to live out in spite of the reaction from the outside world. John Berger expounds on the utility of performance in Caravaggio's context. The underworld's survival and pride depend on theater, a theater where everyone is flamboyantly playing and proving himself, and yet where an individual's survival may well depend on his lying low or his not being seen. The consequent tension produces a special kind of expressive urgency in which gestures fill all the space available, in which a life's desire may be expressed by a glance. The performance can be a means of masking or revealing, finding safety or escape, or becoming a more honest, more actualized self. Theater always has an audience, and these works beg consideration of who is looking and how, even of my own positionality as a spectator. Who has power and privilege? How does it condition our way of seeing? And who has agency in crafting a narrative? Anna Bianchini came to Rome in 1593 and shared a coach with another young woman, Filide Melandroni. Their mothers quickly put them to work as prostitutes, and they were arrested together for solicitation in 1594, ages 14 and 13. This was just 2 years after Caravaggio arrived in Rome. Melandroni would become one of Rome's most famous courtesans and also posed for Caravaggio. Here, Melandroni assumes the role of Mary Magdalene. Next to her is her sister, Martha, possibly played by Bianchini, who is known for her red hair. This painting represents a moment in the story when Jesus came to the home of Mary and Martha. A devout follower of Christ, Martha began preparing the home and offered hospitality to demonstrate her faith. Mary had been living a life of sin and vanity, represented by the trappings of luxury around her: fine clothing, a powder jar, and a comb. But here we see her at a moment of conversion. Divine light illuminates her, entering from a window unseen but in the mirror, and marks her transition to a contemplative life. The mirror is a complicated device. Convex mirrors were luxury objects and commonly represented in painting through the first half of the 16th century. By Caravaggio's time, they had largely fallen out of fashion. Here, it is an object that would have reflected her beauty and vanity, and now represents divine insight and wisdom. But the convex mirror offers a distorted image, an imperfect vision of reality. The story of Mary Magdalene during the Counter-Reformation was one that associated feminine beauty with vanity and immorality, and a godly life with contemplation and renunciation. One historian reads the window's diminutive reflection as the light of God made compatible with a human eye. Caravaggio's inspiration was not just from the biblical story, but also from a long iconography of a woman with a looking glass, a kind of vanitas image, treating a woman's appearance as a device to warn about transient beauty, morality, and death. Mary's convex mirror distorts and reveals not just the light of God for the viewer's eye, but also the convergence of two complex iconographies. Bianchini and Melandroni, cast as pious sisters, represent active and contemplative Christian life, but also prevailing conventions of goodness and femininity. We can think of the words of St. Paul: "Now we see through a glass darkly, but then we shall see face to face." Mirrors for Nan Goldin stand in for fictive space, glimpses of memory and the mutability of what is reflected. They appear frequently in her work, often capturing her subject looking at their own reflection while grooming or getting ready. This photograph offers us two views of the scene. A woman reclines, gazing out of frame, with the hand of another woman resting on her thigh. Bathed in warm light, we see more women reflected in the mirror, all partially dressed, and each languidly arranged in their Paris hotel room. There's a quality of excess and luxury, but also a darkness in Joanna's withdrawn gaze, signaling an underlying sense of distress or vulnerability. Sensuality is suggested in the partially undressed bodies, gauzy fabrics, and the rich reds of the boudoir, and perhaps also drug use, but none are asserted directly. The mirror reveals more of the scene, but clarifies nothing. It suggests conventions of femininity, a kind of vanitas device, and underscores the line between feminine and the demimonde, the hedonistic underworld, and allows us a glimpse of intimacy among women. What we see in the mirror depends on from where we are looking. There is a triangular relationship between subject, reflection, and photographer, all colored by an ambivalent emotional state, somewhere east of melancholy, but not yet at pleasure. The look of decadence, splendor, decay come together in what has been repackaged and marketed to us as heroin chic. Perhaps more removed, but no less critical, is our relationship as the viewer. Among Goldin's work is a project called I'll Be Your Mirror, which implies that it's about the audience. Mirrors, in her words, reflect what you are, in case you don't know. Overt and subtle references to substance use and inebriation have long provoked intrigue and anxiety. In his early career, Caravaggio often used Bacchus, the Roman god of wine and revelry, as a subject in portraiture. This was a common theme in painting at that time, as the god could represent inspiration and creativity in contrast to Apollonian reason. But the subject carried the connotation of underlying threat. Bacchanalian revelry could lay waste to society by bringing upon disorder. In mythology, he destroyed Thebes by luring people to his party. The young man in Caravaggio's portrait assumes this role, but the performance is thin. This lush scene is set upon a dirty mattress. The young god has dirt under his nails as he offers you wine. His chest is pale and smooth, but his face and hands are ruddy and dark. He has a farmer's tan. This signified that the painting subject was not idealized from mythology. He was extracted from the street. He had to work to survive. This was transgressive because he was poor. We must consider the moral perspective from which something is viewed, which is conditional, socially produced, and ever-changing. Nan Goldin's photograph at right shows Kenny passed out in a messy room, farmer's tan on full display. Here, there is nothing to idealize, no myth to tell. In this iconography, the aftermath of a modern bacchanal, revelry quickly turns to disorder. An image like this threatened notions of what was acceptable in art and created friction around the rightness and wrongness of different states of being. After a party, there's always the next morning, always a mess to meet after the pleasures of the night. The bedroom becomes the site where real life takes place for all its pleasure and chaos, and Goldin asserts that these unpolished, interstitial moments are worthy of center stage. Disorder, pleasure, and a loss of bodily autonomy converge in a state of ecstasy. It can come with religious fervor, sensual pleasure, or inebriated revelry, but always brings about a state of altered consciousness or a state of transcendence through emotion. At left, Caravaggio's Saint Francis is overcome during a vision. An angel gently supports his collapsed body, his face serene, and his right hand caresses the stigmata, a sign of embodied empathy with Jesus's pain. In this moment, he understands Christ's suffering and his love, a combined experience of physical joy and pain, of love, beauty, and grief. It is the inherent contradiction of these emotional states that produces ecstatic feeling, the containment of the extreme highs and lows. The transcendence of ecstasy is often more earthly than divine, one that might occur when draped across the hood of a blue convertible, clothes askew, and in the company of friends. Goldin shows a moment of surrender, of the liberating power of abandon and being held by those who see you. In search of earthly ecstasy, many find transcendence in the utopia of the nightclub. In such a subaltern space, pleasure, joy, escape, and community are possible. German photographer Wolfgang Tillmans moved to Hamburg as a teenager in 1987, during a time in which German youth were politically galvanized and exploring new ways of living. For them, dance and drug use underground were an escape from the dystopia outside. The underground is tied to rebellion, where you can seek shelter and pleasure in a space that can hold you, and experience liberation by inhabiting your own body. Like Goldin, Tillmans' photographs are inherently political. He has said, "A lot of the early work was motivated by an interest to keep activism as attractive as clubbing, and even to connect the two. I did not see hedonism and activism as exclusive sites. Only when you are aware of how tragic life can be, can you also enjoy the depth of a party through the night." At left, Caravaggio's Mary Magdalene in ecstasy, an image that captured the Counter-Reformation interest in emotion and fervor, also gives us a glimpse into the reality of his underground world in this darkened interior. For John Berger, again, Caravaggio's chiaroscuro allowed him to banish daylight. Shadows, he felt, offered shelter, as can four walls and a roof. He felt nowhere. He only felt relatively at ease inside. Interior spaces, whether a tavern in 16th century Rome or a Berlin nightclub, offer a sense of containment and protection against hate, against oppressive political regimes, against God. Chiaroscuro can be a place of shelter, a place deep enough to contain ecstasy and melancholy at once. Perhaps one of the most resonant qualities of Caravaggio's work, and one of the most transgressive, is his frank regard toward death and mortality. It so startled his audiences that commissions were rejected and works, now considered masterpieces, were broadly criticized. He was unafraid to place objection front and center, even when it threatened his prospects. This work, called The Death of the Virgin, was commissioned in 1602 and was never installed where it was intended. Canonical representations of the Virgin Mary represented her after death, idealized, and ascending toward heaven. Caravaggio paints her horizontally, surrounded by a dense crowd of mourners. Her lifeless body is partially illuminated by a high light source. She is pale, and her stature is only communicated by a gold, thread-like halo just beyond the crown of her head. Grief is played out in the darkened palette, downcast gazes, hidden faces, and only the Mary Magdalene figure in the foreground is overcome by a fully embodied expression of sadness. Unlike the mannerist tendency to perform emotions loudly, here it's quieter, more private. This is not a work of theater, but of the spectator brought into the congested space of individual and collective grief. This painting was considered heresy and rejected immediately, and it was never installed where it was intended. It was too real, too lifelike, and the real scandal lay in the story surrounding the painter's subject. Caravaggio may have modeled the dead virgin after a woman named Lena, his lover for a time, and a sex worker who drowned in the Tiber River. The intimacy can be seen in the tender regard for this figure, her face painted with the serenity of sleep, but her hands and feet shown swollen, perhaps a sign of posthumous edema. Berger suggests that this is only half the story. The more important half is that the dead woman is laid out as the poor lay out their dead, and the mourners mourn her as the poor mourn, as the poor still mourn. As Caravaggio brings together grief and tenderness, so too do Goldin and Tillmans. The protagonists of Goldin's albums throughout the 1980s were lovers and friends who comprised a community ravaged by the AIDS epidemic. Recurring stars of her images would disappear, and frequently Goldin and her camera bore witness to the effects of disease, not just on the individual, but on those who loved them. This group of four images, sequenced, tells a story of Goldin's friends Gilles and Gaccio, as Gilles eventually succumbed to illness. The subject is candid and raw, and one of arresting intimacy. The first two images in the sequence, however, are critical. Goldin has been explicit in her photography and in her words about her refusal to reduce the identities of her friends to people with AIDS. She shows them in health, in love, and in a positive light, giving breadth and totality to their lives. The subject was personal. It was her life, it was her love, it was her grief. She reflected, "I had thought that I could stave off loss through photographing. I always thought if I photographed anyone or anything enough, I would never lose the person. I would never lose the memory, I would never lose the place. But the pictures show me how much I've lost." Tillmans, too, with similar delicacy and tenderness, documented his partner Jochen Klein's AIDS-related illness in 1997. This photograph is the only one from this period directly representing Klein. The rest offer just a glimpse of an object or space, a still life cut with grief. Goldin and Tillmans' images are characteristically tender and unflinching, and could bring the lens close because they were close. They insist that death is a part of life, and they assert the totality of their world in their images. For all their beauty and pain, mortality and fragility, they are, as critic Bruce Hanley described, Caravaggio in the drag of now. I wonder if Caravaggio felt a sense of loss as a man perpetually on the run. He left Rome in 1606 to flee a murder charge. He would go to Malta, Naples, and Sicily, but never settled. The circumstances of his death in 1610, aged 38, are shrouded in mystery. I wonder what enabled him to tell such human stories of pain and feeling and desire. This photograph was taken just after Klein's death in the midst of the artist's grief. Tillmans has long been inspired by Caravaggio, and here he reveals the source of light, letting daylight flood in, showing us the source directly. The window is still dotted with postcards of works by the original master of light, our Lucifer, who has provided us with the language for how to bring light to darkness, how not to fear what lurks in the shadows. Caravaggio made the characters of the street and the underground the protagonists of biblical stories and secular mythologies. He thrust them to center stage in the stories from which they had been cast out. What Goldin and Tillmans can do centuries later is capture their realities without masking, without dressing it up, and carry Caravaggio's torch of fearless naturalism. Nan Goldin describes this realness. "My desire is to preserve the sense of people's lives, to endow them with the strength and beauty I see in them. I want the people in my pictures to stare back. I want to show exactly what my world looks like without glamorization, without glorification. This is not a bleak world, but one in which there is an awareness of pain, a quality of introspection. Real memory, which these pictures trigger, is an invocation of the color, smell, sound, and physical presence, the density and flavor of life." In this intimacy and in this closeness, John Berger suggests the physical sense of Caravaggio. His darkness smells of candles, overripe melons, damp washing waiting to be hung out the next day. It is the darkness of stairwells, gambling corners, cheap lodgings, sudden encounters. And when the promise is not, and the promise is not in what will flare against it, but in the darkness itself. If, when shadows beckon, might it be an invitation to live passionately, to live honestly and without pretense? The paintings are on view here for 3 more days. Go see them, be dazzled by them, revel in their darkness and their light, and in yours. I think we have a few minutes for questions, and there are staff members with microphones. So if you have any questions or anything you'd like to share, please do. Please raise your hand, and I'd love to hear from you.
I'm curious why you didn't have any images. There was a documentary about Nan Goldin released last year, which had some of these images and went into more of her life's work and some of the exhibits you talked about, but you concentrated on her photographs. Is it to be a parallel to Caravaggio's pictures?
Sure. So you're wondering why I didn't include more about the documentary that she participated in? That's a great question. I wanted to focus sort of on the still images that she produced, especially in the early years of her work. But I think there is, a lot of her projects are very iterative, which is to say that she comes back and reworks a lot of these slideshows and a lot of these series over time. So I think her early works are always in conversation with the things that she's doing now. So if you're interested in Nan Goldin, I highly encourage you to check out films that are made with her and about her, because it's pertinent, and there is, I think, a lot of relationship to Caravaggio. Thank you.
Thank you for such a wonderful talk. I wondered if Caravaggio ever painted nudes, and if not, if that's another sort of chiaroscuro, he's hiding the figure with fabric as he might with darkness. I wondered if you could speak to that, especially in relation to the club photography.
Yeah, absolutely. He did depict nudes, many of them. And they were, as you can imagine, based on other things we've discussed, they were criticized because they were so realistic. They were so unidealized. And sort of similar to other painters at that time, where there was sort of a complex relationship to nudity. It would often be a nude figure among other figures who are dressed, sometimes in contemporary dress, sometimes in kind of a more like an interpretation of what biblical dress may have been. But absolutely, there were nudes, and they were kind of all with this, you know, the dirty nails, the dirty feet. They really, really looked like figures from life, and for that, Caravaggio got a lot of flack.
Oh, hi. Yeah, I was just curious where the Nan Goldin's from, as a photographer. Where she grew up, where she was born? Where she did her work, mostly.
All over the place. The images I showed, she was born just outside of D.C., grew up in Boston, and then moved to New York in her late teens or early 20s. A lot of the images were produced that I showed today in New York, some in Paris, but a lot of kind of the ones in her early period were kind of around New York, Berlin, Bangkok, Paris, and now she lives primarily in Europe. But she's had a very kind of international career, and her subjects are very international.
with, we know that Tillman, I believe was directly influenced by Caravaggio and chiaroscuro. Do we know if some of the photos he and Goldin took were direct references to Caravaggio's work?
That's a great question. as you can imagine, that's one that I've been grappling with a lot. For Nan Goldin's part, I think she would say no. But the parallels are really kind of striking sometimes. She's more recently done a lot of still lifes that really look a lot like, you know, period still lifes, whether they're Caravaggio's or others from the late 16th and early 17th centuries. But she is someone who thought a lot about how he treated light. You know, a flash of a camera does a lot what you might do in paint with light and dark. I don't think she ever intended to replicate his compositions directly. And Tillmans also, I don't think he was ever trying to do a one-to-one. But in that final image, this one, I think he lays it out pretty clearly that what Caravaggio achieves with light and darkness is very, very much related to the work of a photographer. Thank you for that question. That's a great question.
We have time for one last question.
Yes, I was just wondering if you could just give a brief summary of how you were able to get these paintings on loan, because you don't see too many Caravaggio paintings in America. So I was just curious, and I know you had the one from London a couple of years ago, The Last Supper, but just curious how you got these from Texas and Detroit.
Oh, that's a great question, and one that I don't really know a full answer to. I myself am not a curator, so I was not involved in any of the planning process. I get to have the fun job of just interpreting the works. But you're correct that there are very few Caravaggios in the United States, and so these two are domestic loans. They are both from the United States, and I'm not sure how many other Caravaggios there are here. Well, thank you. Thanks for coming.